Welcome to Disneyland USA. Today we're booked for a very special trip. This train usually goes around the park, but today it's going someplace else, back through time. We're going to relive the greatest moments in Disneyland's history. And we get to ride here in the parlor car. This is exciting. I've been coming here for years, but I've never gotten to do this.
All aboard.
Sounds like they're ready to go. Come on.
To all the world.
The Disneyland Story with your host, Harry Anderson.
Wow, this time travel stuff is all right. I feel like a kid again. Of course, I won't be born for 20 years. The Disneyland Story. So this is where it all began.
Won't you tell us all about it?
Start at the beginning.
Yeah. And when you come to the end, stop.
It's 1928. Walt Disney has rolled the dice and won. Looky, 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 come see the world's first talking cartoon, Steamboat Willie, featuring that young and debonair star of the stage and screen, Mr. Mickey Mouse. Well, Mickey becomes an international star, and Walt Disney begins to dream of an adventure into a new frontier of fun and fantasy. Saturday is Daddy's Day at the Disney household, so Walt takes his two little girls to ride the merry-go-round. While his kids have all the fun, he's stuck on a park bench with a bag of peanuts. Walt wonders, why isn't there a place where children and their parents can have fun together?
Very lovely thought,
but not at all practical.
The amusement parks of the 30s are dirty, dangerous tourist traps for suckers and their kids. Walt's opinion of these places is summed up in this scene from Pinocchio.
There's something phony about all this. I've got to get him out of here.
This joint ought to be busted by the health department. Walt resolves to build a new kind of park, a theme park. But where? His first inspiration comes to him from a young fan. Dear Mr. Disney, I love Mickey Mouse and Snow White, and when we go on vacation, I would like to come visit them. And you, too. Well, this is not the first request to see where the Disney characters live. So Walt decides that the perfect home for his dream park would be right at his very own studios. The Disney artists draw up countless plans. But the dream is bigger than the land. So a great location hunt is launched. The terrain near the famous Hollywood Bowl? Too rugged. It's much too expensive to build near LA's towering 1953 skyscrapers. But if you head south on one of California's new uncongested freeways, you come to the orange groves of Anaheim. There he is, America's leading film pioneer, tromping around in an orange grove. Seems like Walt's finally lost it.
What a peculiar place to have a party.
Well, it may seem peculiar, but Walt knows better. Now all he's got to do is convince the world.
After all, this is going to be an expensive dream.
From the very start, it was a problem of getting the money to open Disneyland. And we had everything mortgaged, including my my family. But it takes a lot of money to make these dreams come true.
Almost nobody believes in Walt's dream or wants to help pay for it. He assembles an unparalleled creative staff, but his plans fail to attract investors who will gamble on his high-priced experiment. Only the Disney studio employees have faith. They offer to invest in the project themselves. But rather than passing the hat, Walt turns to his financial genius of a brother, Roy, for help. Roy convinces Walt to take his dream to the people through a brand new medium, television. Armed with this single sketch, Walt convinces a TV network to help finance his dream. In return, he produces Disneyland, the television show.
A thing like that ought to be worth a fortune to someone. Now, let me see.
It's a marriage made in the Magic Kingdom. The network gets a hit series, and Walt gets to show the entire nation what Disneyland, the place, will be like.
Now we want you to share with us our latest and greatest dream. That's it, right here. Disneyland, seen from about 2,000 feet in the air and 10 months away.
Shooting out from here, like the four cardinal points of the compass, Disneyland is divided into four cardinal realms. Adventureland, Tomorrowland, Fantasyland, and Frontierland.
We hope that it will be unlike anything else on this earth. A place of hopes and dreams, facts and fancy, all in one.
Every Wednesday night, Walt updates America on the construction of the happiest place on earth. There's excitement in the air, and on the ground, too, where things are happening fast. Sometimes too fast. Each tree of the orange grove is marked with a foolproof system. Red ribbons to clear, green to save. Hey, that bulldozer's plowing through everything. Can you believe this? The driver's colorblind. There's the newly dug rivers of America. Pretty impressive. But on the Fill the River Day, the torrents of water magically disappear into the sandy soil. Well, back to the old drawing board. Construction costs spiral upward. Even with the support of a major television network, the investment money is quickly exhausted. But instead of eliminating some attractions or cutting corners on others, Walt comes up with a great idea. Recycling. These horses are corralled at Coney Island, New York, and herded 3,000 miles to Walt's studio stables. The giant squid from the movie 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea will be taking up residence in Tomorrowland. Even the trees in Adventureland are rescued from the path of the new LA freeways. Well, when the landscaping money runs out, Walt instructs the gardeners to label the native weeds and shrubs with a few fancy Latin names. Genus Bogus Botanicus. Ragweed. Construction becomes a race with the clock. If this park isn't ready for the summer crowds and vacationing families, it's going to mean almost certain financial ruin. Okay, coffee break's over, guys. Let's see a little hustle.
Come on over, baby. A whole lot of shaking going on.
Come alive, you slobs.
Come on over, baby. Maybe you can't go wrong.
Who can do it?
Honey, I ain't begging. I got a whole lot of shaking going on. Let's go on time now.
You know the penalty if you fail.
I'm aying for a surprise.
I gotta hear the left guitar now. Shake it, baby, shake it. Shake it, baby, shake it. Come on now, shake it. Don't you let it break. But you gotta shake, oh baby, shake it. Come on on, oh, shake it. Come on.
I just love happy endings.
Down to the wire, but they made it. On July 17th, 1955, 1 year after groundbreaking, Disneyland is ready for its televised grand opening, and the whole world is watching.
It's the biggest live event in television history. Bringing us all the color in glorious black and white are three of the greatest television personalities of the day. Bob Cummings, Ronald Reagan, and Art Linkletter.
That's not Art Linkletter. That's Mickey Mouse, the inimitable little character that started this whole story with Walt Disney 25 years ago. Perhaps the most popular motion picture star in Hollywood. Well, I feel like Santa Claus with a $17 million bundle of gift packages all wrapped in whimsy and sent your way over television with the help of 29 cameras. Let's take a look around. There's the City Hall, Main Street, USA, and every one of those buildings is 5/8 real size. Ronnie Reagan will take it away for the dedication ceremonies to Disneyland.
All activity on Main Street has ceased. And now, Walt Disney will step forward to read the dedication of Disneyland.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome. Disneyland is your land. Here age relives fond memories of the past, and here youth may savor the challenge and promise of the future. Disneyland is dedicated to the ideals, the dreams, and the hard facts that have created America, with the hope that it will be a source of joy and inspiration to all the world.
To show the viewers that Disneyland is really like an old friend. Each land will be patterned after famous Disney films they already know.
You must join us in a cup of tea.
Representing Frontierland is Fess Parker, the star of Walt's first hit TV series.
When he was only three,
Davy Crockett, king of the wild frontier.
Fantasyland is led by the Disney characters. Well, anyway, I think they're Disney characters. There's Snow White and seven early dwarfs. And here's Tomorrowland's very own spaceman. Let's check out the proceedings in the rest of the park, starting with our exotic tour guide, Bob Cummings.
Now, we are now at the beginning of a true life adventure into a still unconquered and untamed region of our own world. A Tahitian village where you can experience a slice of life as it exists in the paradise of the Pacific. And an African trading post, the spearhead of head of civilization in those primitive lands. Now, we're all loaded up, I believe. Thank you, Captain. You can take her off. We're ready for a ride down the tropical waterways of the world.
And that volley signals the arrival of a wagon train with the first visitors to travel through the gates of time and into our very historic past. And now, inside Frontierland to Art Linkletter.
It's my pleasure to introduce the lovely lady and famous star whom Mr. Disney has asked to christen the Mark Twain. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Irene Dunne.
Hello, Irene. Hello, how are you? It's listening.
It's listening a little because it'll be shoving off in a moment.
Hey, somebody on the port side ought to try a salad for lunch. The Mark Twain was the first paddle wheeler built in the United States in 50 years. Walt loved it so much that he mortgaged his own home to help pay for its construction.
Well, now, Miss Dunne, you're holding a very special bottle here in your arms.
Yes, I am, Walt.
Did she say Walt?
This bottle contains waters from all the leading rivers in America.
Brought here from all these towns by the great rivers.
That's right. So with these precious waters, I'm going to christen this boat the Mark Twain.
And there the boat is christened, and it starts on its daily trips up and down the rivers of the world. Of America, that is.
The Mark Twain as she gets ready to start on her maiden voyage. The Mark Twain, a proud symbol of that romantic era when whole cities grew out of river ports. That Reagan fella sure has a way with words. Wonder whatever became of him. Maybe we can learn something about his future over in Tomorrowland.
Those doves are, ladies and gentlemen, I hope, the harbingers of peace for the world of tomorrow. And now, here in Disneyland, the year is 1986. 1986. That's way ahead. Yes, this is Tomorrowland. It's not a stylized dream of the future, but a scientifically planned projection of future techniques by leading space experts and scientists.
1986, huh? Well, they were pretty close. Anyway, that rocket was boss. It'll be handy for negotiating those 1986 LA freeways.
Now we're in Autopia, about a mile of superhighway adventure. And look who's riding in the various cars. Frank Sinatra! Hello, Franco. Who's driving? Frankie Jr.?
My son, yes.
Don't hit this man. Oh. Look who hit who. Sammy Davis Jr. Hello, Sammy.
Well, Disneyland's debut broadcast is right on track. For live television shot with 29 cameras, things are coming off without a hitch, so far.
Right now, Bob Cummings is at the, where is he?
And I see Art Linkletter right now. Art Linkletter is looking for a microphone. He looks all confused. There's been something gone wrong here for just an instant.
Let's read these few words of dedication. A vista into a world of wondrous ideas, signifying man's achievements. I thought I got a signal.
Don't sweat it, Walt. We love you anyway, big guy. The bloopers on TV are just the tip of the iceberg. Wise guys print up counterfeit tickets, which bring in more people than the park can handle. A plumber strike causes a shortage of drinking fountains. The ladies' high heels sink in the hot asphalt streets, and they have to walk right out of their shoes. To the Disney inner circle, opening day becomes known as Black Sunday.
Oh, the shame of it.
Now, just a minute. That's going too far.
Hang the papers. It'll be forgotten tomorrow.
Nice try, Cruella. But the fuming reporters aren't the only problem. Even the animals are revolting. The pack mules picnic on the little kids' hats, and the donkeys sit down on the job. Steam whistles stampede the stage ponies. Frontierland's Wild West is a little too wild. And to top it off, a record heat wave drives attendance down to a trickle. Many people doubt that Walt's Dreamland will survive childhood at all.
I have an excellent idea. Let's change the subject.
There's an idea, Rabbit. Let's keep this story rolling. Even though it's been a shaky start, the park is now open, and it's beginning to grow. Even that barren frontier starts to look more mature. The sparsely planted trees are quickly becoming full-fledged forests. The lonely Mark Twain is joined by keelboats, rafts, and canoes, and by the proud Columbia, the first three-masted windjammer built in the U.S. in 100 years. Walt's biggest goal in the first 12 months is to catch up with growing public demand by more than doubling the number of attractions. So, Walt sends his designers back to the drawing boards again. They come up with the first daily operating monorail in the Western Hemisphere, the eighth largest submarine fleet in the world, and towering above it all, Disneyland's first thrill ride, Matterhorn Mountain. Boy, I'll never forget the first time I rode the Matterhorn. Next time, I'll save the hot dog till after the ride. On hand for the opening celebration is Vice President Richard Nixon. As you can see, the usual opening day gremlins also sneaked in. This time, they won't let the scissors cut the ribbon, so Walt takes matters into his own hands.
That's not it.
That's why he's the boss. Are rocking to a close, and the whole world is catching on to Disneyland. Hey, there's India's Prime Minister Nehru. Nice jacket. There's my pal, the King of Nepal, and President Eisenhower. Ike likes it. But one eager would-be visitor throws a tantrum when he can't come to Disneyland.
We work according to what the State Department wants to do. When they come in, they have guests. If he's Khrushchev was a guest of the government, and our chief of police, he just was a little worried. But we were ready for him. The press was ready. We had different shots, places where we'd take pictures with Khrushchev, and I had one that was my favorite, where we'd lined up in front of my 8 submarines. You see, and I thought, well, it'd be nice. I've been pointing to Mr. Khrushchev and saying, well, now, Mr. Khrushchev, here's my Disneyland submarine fleet.
But it's the race for space that kicks off the 60s. And the Disney Imagineers use the new space technologies to launch a new era of electronic pixie dust.
Let's all sing like the birdies sing. Ba-ba-boo, ba-ba-boo.
Puppet without strings.
Just as we had to learn to make our animated cartoons talk, we had to find a way to make these characters talk too. Now, to accomplish this, we created a new type of animation. So new that we had to invent a new name for it.
Audio animatronics?
Right, audio animatronics. Audio for sound.
See, and electronically animated by sound.
That's what
he's trying to say.
Thank you. That's what he's trying to say.
Excuse me, Walt.
It's okay.
After the success of the talking tiki birds, everyone wants to invest in Walt's new technology. And he's only too happy to oblige. These new toys are expensive. So Walt enlists corporate sponsors to fund construction of 4 entirely new shows for the 64-65 World's Fair in New York.
You might be wondering how an animation studio like ours got into the World's Fair business. And frankly, I've often wondered about that myself. But we've been preparing for this international exposition for many years without realizing it. Little did we know, when we dreamed up Mickey and Donald here, that someday they would be the ancestors of the mammoth animated characters we've created for this fair, such as this Tyrannosaurus Rex here. The building of Disneyland gave us a new art and a new type of artist. One that works with a slide rule and a blowtorch instead of pencil and brush. These fellows are building a Tyrannosaurus Rex, weighing over 20,000 pounds. He'll be the heavy in our show Magic Skyway, a drama of prehistoric days. Since I was a small boy in Illinois, I've had a great personal admiration for Abraham Lincoln. So when we decided to recreate some of the great moments in Mr. Lincoln's life for the World's Fair, we directed all our energies to that task. The final result is so lifelike that you might find it hard to believe.
All the armies of Europe, Asia, and Africa combined could not by force take a drink from the Ohio, or make a track on the Blue Ridge in a trial of 1,000 years.
But with all these projects and a weekly TV show, when does Walt Disney find time to sleep?
Mrs. Disney called. She wants to know, since you didn't make it home for Christmas, do you think you can for Easter?
I doubt it, but tell her I'll see you at the fair.
Oh, that reminds me, I should call my wife. Nah, you probably can't reverse charges from 1964.
Now, another of our World Fair exhibits that features the audio animatronics is the Carousel Theater of Progress. Now, this contraption here might look like something from outer space, but it's actually a control harness for programming the actions and gestures of our audio animatronic figures. Shall we show them how it works?
Ready, Walt.
This is the Carousel Theater host. Whatever the man in the harness does, this figure will respond simultaneously in the same manner. This electronically controlled method of programming can give us a wide range of movements. A broad gesture, the wink of an eye. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Boy, an animatronic host. Of course, I'm the real thing. Hey, cut it out, guys. That's not funny.
Our exhibit called It's a Small World is a salute to the United Nations Children's Fund. Our musical fantasy features the songs and dances of youngsters from more than 100 nations. each singing in his own native language. Now, when the current World's Fair ends, all four of our shows will find a permanent home at Disneyland, USA.
Four brand new attractions, all coming home for a special celebration back at the Orange Grove. It's Disneyland's 10th birthday, and everyone is joining Disney's latest movie star, Mary Poppins, for a gigantic birthday party.
Merry at birthday to me,
to me.
Oh, yeah. A merry at birthday to you.
Oh, me?
Yes, you.
Oh, me.
It's all congratulations with another cup of tea. A merry, merry and a birthday to you.
A merry, merry.
10 Centennial Celebration and the four New York shows are a major hit, and the biggest expansion in the park's history is underway.
Disneyland has always had a big river and a Mississippi sternwheeler. It seemed appropriate to create a new attraction at the bend of the river, and so Disneyland's New Orleans Square came into being.
New Orleans Square is Walt's biggest hit yet. And Disney's TV audience can hardly wait for the arrival of the Scurvy Pirates of the Caribbean. Har, har, cut off me leg and call me Peggy. Har, har, har. Thanks again to television. By the time the Pirates of the Caribbean opens, everyone in America will already know these rascally characters. Walt would have been proud of his pirate success, but before the debut, Walt Disney takes a last look at his living dream.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry. Much more than I ever knew, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Well, I think by this time, my young group of executives are convinced that Walt is right, that quality will out. Give the public everything you can give them. Keep the place as clean as you can keep it. Keep it friendly. I think they're convinced, and I think that'll hang on after, after Disney.
Ooh, yeah.
On December 15th, 1966, the world says goodbye to its greatest dreamer. Newscaster Eric Severide puts into words what so many Americans feel in their hearts. Walt Disney was an original. Not just an American original, but an original, period. What Disney seemed to know was that while there is very little grown-up in every child, there is a lot of child in every grown-up. We will never see his like again. Walt's brother Roy takes the helm. Roy Disney, long the business genius behind the park, continues work on Disneyland's next attraction, the Haunted Mansion. Ooh, I bet it's going to be spooky. But should the mansion be scary or funny? To spook or not to spook? That becomes the first controversy of the after Disney era. Imagineers on one side say people love to be frightened.
They say the old place is haunted or bewitched or some such fiddle-faddle.
Fiddle-faddle and rot, sir.
But not the little kids, counters the opposition.
Ooh, it's dark inside.
In the end, the mansion becomes more light than fright. Kind of a happy haunting ground for the whole family. Good, now I can go there with my five-year-old. Otherwise, she'd have to go alone.
As the moon climbs high over the dead oak tree, Creepy creeps with eerie eyes. Grim grin and ghosts come out to socialize.
Is he gone? You know, they say Disneyland's ghosts aren't all in the Haunted Mansion. After all the visitors have gone home, other kinds of gremlins come out of hiding and set about their mysterious tasks. And all this work goes on after midnight. Disneyland comes up with a dazzler. Wow! It's the Main Street Electrical Parade with over 500,000 light bulbs. I wonder if they'd loan me one for my refrigerator. There's something new, a second mountain at Disneyland. The Matterhorn was the world's first steel thriller ride. And now it's the twisting, turbulent world of Space Mountain. Uh-oh, trouble in paradise. It seems Space Mountain's success in Tomorrowland has made a few of the residents of Frontierland a wee bit jealous. So it isn't long before the country bears get a mountain of their own. Big Thunder.
Hey,
1984. Attendance is up, but Disney stock is down. And the company is fighting a hostile takeover bid that could split it apart.
Is it possible?
Isn't there some mistake?
Mickey Mouse. You know, Mickey Mouse? I hope you've heard of me. I hope.
When the smoke clears, the Disney Company emerges stronger than ever, with friendly investors and a new chairman of the board, Michael Eisner.
You can't rest on your laurels. You can't sit and say, well, it's all great now and beautiful, and 10 years from now, it'll be the same. It won't be. Time moves on, and you have to reinvest.
One of his first dreams is to bring some of Hollywood's greatest entertainers into the Disney fold. First, he corrals Michael Jackson to star in the 3D spectacular Captain EO. Wow! How'd he do that? Following in Walt's footsteps, Eisner models park attractions on hit movies. Again, he combines the state-of-the-art technology of the Disney Imagineers with Star Wars creator George Lucas, and presto, Star Tours is launched.
Hello, I am C-3PO Human-Cyborg Relations. Welcome aboard the Star Speeder 3000. Galactic regulations require that all carry-on items be safely stowed beneath your seats. Oh, and flash photography and smoking are absolutely prohibited while on board. Thank you.
The clockwork precision with which the park's rides are run is a Disneyland tradition. But along comes Star Tours, and it's a whole new deal. Passengers are soon careening through the galaxy at the mercy of a bumbling robot pilot.
Hi there!
45, you're going the wrong way. Stop immediately.
Uh-oh, wrong way! Brakes! Brakes! Where are the brakes?
With the dry Southern California summers, park guests get thirsty for some relief from the heat. People want to get wet.
No, splash, Captain.
Sir, you want to splash, Mr. Starkey.
I'll give you a splash!
As you can see, I'd much prefer to be at Disneyland on Splash Mountain than anywhere else. Nevertheless, we're in the serious business of presenting entertainment, and I think I got my inspiration, as it were, from Walt Disney. I think it was on the 10th anniversary, where he said, we're just beginning. I couldn't believe watching television that Walt Disney said 10 years later, we're just beginning. And here I am 35 years later, feeling exactly the same way. We are just beginning, and Disneyland is really an evolutionary entertainment force and our pilot. And I'm proud to say that After 35 years, I'm part of an organization that is just beginning.
Well, that pretty much brings us back to today. So far, this trip's been a window into the past, but we've got enough left to peek a bit into the future, too. 1991 will see the young Indiana Jones in his own adventure spectacular and an incredible live Muppet show. The Little Mermaid, Ariel, and her friend Sebastian the Crab will swim onto the scene in 1993. One year later, George Lucas returns to Disneyland with Alien Encounter. 1996, Dick Tracy's Crime Stoppers, combining state-of-the-art technology with a classic story from the past. Further ahead, Baby Herman's Runaway Buggy Ride through a whole new area in the park, Hollywoodland, where park guests will appear in classic films of yesterday and television of tomorrow. Through already, huh? Wow, that was a tremendous ride, wasn't it? You know, everyone told Walt that Disneyland was going to be a Hollywood spectacular, a spectacular failure. But I think he knew something they didn't. Already, over 300 million visitors from every country in the world have come to be a part of the Disneyland story. Some failure. And right now, there are more visitors arriving to write the next chapter. I'm going to join them. Bye for now.
When you wish upon a star, makes no difference who you are. Anything your heart desires will come to you. If your heart is in your dream, no request is too